The Cold War is often viewed as a time where the world was afraid of nuclear holocaust, one that would wipe out mankind. However, if there's one thing that helps define humanity, it's our ingenuity and efficiency when it comes to creating ways to kill each other, which goes well beyond splitting the atom. Biological and chemical warfare agents and their effects have, of course, been tested in laboratories and on the battlefield, but also on the civilian populations of the state that developed them, without prior consent, we might add. I'm your host, David, and this week we are going to look at the Dorset Biological Warfare Experiments, a series of biological warfare tests conducted by the British government using the people of Dorset as an unknowing test subject. This is the Cold War. I wake up every day looking forward to the opportunity to learn new ideas and new perspectives, which is why I am so pleased to be working with the sponsor of today's video, Magellan TV. Magellan TV offers documentaries on a wide range of topics and even arranges them into thematic playlists to make learning a topic even easier. History's Verdict is a series exploring some of the significant leaders of the 20th century, including Stalin, the Soviet Union's Man of Steel, the man who solidified the Soviet Union into a global superpower. And if you prefer exploring the natural world instead, Magellan TV has you covered. Check out the Majestic Earth playlist and celebrate the uniqueness and beauty of our planet with hours of documentaries. And the good news is Magellan TV has even more than that. There are more than 3,000 documentaries waiting for you, and hundreds of them are on the history of various periods from the ancient world all the way to the modern era. New documentaries are added weekly and available on most devices, including phones and PCs. Magellan TV has a kind and exclusive offer for our viewers. Click the link in the description to get a 1 month free trial and watch hundreds of history documentaries anytime, anywhere. By the time of the Cold War, the concept of using aerosol agents to infect humans through the respiratory tract wasn't anything new. It had its origins in the 1940s, and despite the fact that in nature, people are less prone to contracting infections via the respiratory tract than other ways, this method was considered optimal because of its simplicity and efficiency in spreading the stimulant over a large area. The United Kingdom, although the focus of this video, wasn't the only one interested in conducting such experiments, testing the spread of biological factors over its cities to see how it spread. The United States had in 1950, as part of Operation Sea Spray, sprayed a combination of the bacteria Serratia marcescens and Bacillus globigi over the San Francisco Bay Area from an offshore ship in order to determine the city's vulnerability to an attack by biological weapons. The bacteria, which were considered harmless to humans, did cause at least 11 cases of a rare urinary tract disease, as well as one death. It was also suspected to be responsible for a later rise in cases of pneumonia in the San Francisco area, but this has never been proven. For the UK trials, the premise was the same. The test agents being used in place of real agents had to mimic a bioweapon as closely as possible in terms of its physiochemical, biological, and immunological characteristics, but it obviously couldn't have the pathogenicity and the toxicity of an actual weapon. After all, you wouldn't want your citizens and test subjects to die, would you? It's bad for headlines. For the first experiments, the bioweapon scientists from Porton Down, a science park near Salisbury, which was home to the Ministry of Defense's Defense Science and Technology Laboratory, used fluorescent particles, specifically zinc cadmium sulfide, a material that had long been used for studying meteorological phenomena, with the first batches supplied by the New Jersey Zinc Company. These first tests were limited to the grounds of Porton Range in Wiltshire, and the spread of the substance was assessed by counting the microscopic impact dots on sampling devices under ultraviolet light. Gradually, the trials became larger and larger. While in the first 2 years of tests, they covered areas in and around Porton, 1956 and 1957 tests involved a plane flying 50 miles off the east coast of the island, creating a 250-mile-long source line. In 1959, this experiment was somewhat repeated, albeit this time it was a ship, HMS Blackpool, sailing from Chatham to Londonderry. Blackpool laid down two source lines, one in the English Channel and the other in the Irish Sea. The sampling, taking place across the entire country, showcased that the United Kingdom, as a result of the island's geography, was extremely vulnerable to this type of biowarfare attack. This concept is widely known as Large Area Coverage, or LAC, borrowing its name from the US operations conducted during 1957 and 1958 that basically involved similar experiments. Uncle Sam's inquiry into these fields shouldn't come as a surprise, however, since we just mentioned the San Francisco trials that acted as a prelude for operations in the UK. The US tests were, of course, followed by more experimentation. The results of Operation LAC in the US were quite interesting themselves, as well as terrifying, by the way. During the first test, air masses coming down from Canada propelled some of the particles some 1,200 miles away into New York State and Canada, while during the second trial, they were pushed all the way south to the Gulf of Mexico. But back at Porton Down, after the success of the trials using the zinc-cadmium compounds, the scientists focused on the next step, which was, naturally, using microorganisms in aerosol form to mimic a bioweapon agent. The area of Porton Down was soon deemed to be too small for the types of tests the biowarfare specialists wanted to run, so an alternative location was picked, South Dorset and particularly Lyme Bay, although some experiments took place in nearby Weymouth Bay as well. Three main reasons made this area stand out from other possibly suitable locations. First, it was close to the Porton Down labs. Two, it had a dockyard that could be used by the ship that would spread the aerosol. And finally, the unique, almost semicircular shape of Lyme Bay allowed the experiments to go forward regardless of the winds that were blowing. Well, almost all winds. So, on the 14th of November, 1963, the experimental trials vessel, Ice Whale, set sail from Royal Naval Air Station Portland towards Portland Bill to begin the first trial. Beginning at approximately 1:30 in the afternoon and lasting for about 30 minutes, the ship sprayed a massive 108-liter aerosol cloud of bacteria. In following experiments, that volume of compound was increased to 488 liters. The aerosol cloud that was sprayed was made up of live microorganisms, specifically two different types of bacteria, Bacillus globigi, also known as Bacillus atrophaeus, a longtime favorite of the Porton Down team as it mimicked anthrax. The second strain used was Escherichia coli, a very common bacteria which normally simply gets shortened to E. coli. Now, both of these bacteria were considered to be relatively benign. BG was considered harmless to humans at the time, but during the late 1990s, scientists reluctantly admitted that the bacteria could cause illness in people who were already in poor health. E. coli, on the other hand, causes no problems when it's where it's supposed to be, but when found in other organs of the body, it can cause infections. As for the possible health issues these bacteria could cause to the citizens of Dorset, well, these were not considered serious. Porton Down continued with the trials, which, with the exception of the first, were conducted under the cover of night, both for secrecy reasons, as well as to protect the E. coli from the sun, as the bacteria is known to be photosensitive. As the trials went on, the area used was gradually expanded, especially during the second year, with the bacterial cloud reaching as far as Devon in the west and Hampshire in the east. Okay, so once the aerosol cloud had been released from the ship, the winds would carry and disperse the bacteria inland, where mobile sampling teams would collect air samples to bring with them to the laboratory for counting. This process gave the scientists at Porton Down a rough approximation of the dosage a person would have received if they were exposed to the bacterial cloud. A total of 27 trials were conducted during the first 2 years of the experiments, held between October of 1963 to May 1965, with the aim of determining how far the bacteria could spread, its concentration at various distances, and whether they still retained their immunological properties after traveling long distances in the atmosphere. All of this information was considered crucial for the development of equipment that could detect possible bioweapons. The conclusion reached during these experiments was that open air played a significant role in the survivability of the bacteria. In lab conditions, static air led to much higher survival rates for the microorganisms, but in the wild, outdoor air severely reduced both the survivability and infectivity of the pathogens. Additionally, the survivability of the bacteria was highly dependent on the size of the particle that contained the pathogen. The open air factor, or OAF as it was dubbed, was later found to quickly disappear once ventilation rates dropped. Future experiments were conducted to test if there was a way to protect the bacteria from the OAF by using various substances to coat them. By 1966, the scope of the experiments shifted slightly towards the detection of the agent, along with early warning, with the area used for testing being South and West Dorset. Few details of the operations themselves changed, with Ice Whale continuing to release massive amounts of the bacterial aerosol cloud towards the unsuspecting citizens of southern England, and with scientists from the Microbiological Research Establishment, or MRE, on land collecting samples. This time, however, the findings from the Ice Whale experiments were compared with the findings of another set of experiments called the Microthread Trials. The Microthread Trials were a series of tests by the scientists at Port and Down who figured out how to use the sticky threads produced by spiders to produce a surprisingly durable frame that was used to encase the bacteria that would later be exposed to various environments. This new technique proved to be a much more trustworthy emulation than the test spheres that had been used in the past, and various trials were held at MRE itself, Maiden Castle, and Port and Longbill in 1965, and of course later on in Dorset. MRE's beloved test area continued to host further experiments in both 1966 and 1967, in which the open air factor and shielding from it were tested. In these spray trials, Ice Whale released two different bacterial clouds. They were still the all too familiar BG and E. coli aerosols, but the bacteria in the second cloud were also coated with a protective substance, a derivative of a fatty alcohol codenamed S3. The substance proved to be quite successful in protecting the bacteria from the effects of the OAF, a result that pleased the British scientists, but certainly not the people of Dorset, or we assume so anyway, had they even known of the experiments at the time, since the success of S3 meant that they were being exposed to far larger doses than during previous trials. Following these trials, the staff at Port and Down took a break in order to plan the next phase of the experiments, a comparison between the British bioweapon detection system, called the Radioactive Labeled Antibody Technique, also known by the acronym RAST, and the detection systems created by the United States. It took until November of 1971 for MRE scientists to return to Dorset and Port Longbill to resume the bioweapon experiments. Trials simulating battlefield conditions were held at a second location, the Portland Range. Once again, ETV Ice Whale was deployed to spray the bacterial aerosols that would be carried inland by the wind, where British and American devices were waiting to detect them. This time, however, only BG made a return as E. coli was replaced by Serratia marcescens, a bacteria that was preferred by the US Biological Warfare Department and was erroneously believed at that time to be non-pathogenic. The DICE trials, as they were known, provided British and American scientists valuable information regarding the UK's vulnerability to the potential tactical and strategic use of biological weapons, as well as real-time detection of such attacks. The trials in Dorset ended in 1975, but experiments in other locations continued to be held for the next couple of years. These biological warfare tests were kept secret for the next 20 years until 1996, after the end of the Cold War, when the first three MRE reports on the field trials were released to the Public Record Office. As you might have guessed, the citizens of Dorset were not pleased to learn that for more than a decade, they had continuously been subjected to biological warfare experiments and were deeply concerned about long-term health issues those innocent bacteria might have caused. The topic of the Dorset biological warfare trials even reached the House of Commons on the 12th of November, 1997, and after mounting pressure from concerned citizens, the government yielded and agreed to let an independent microbiologist study the simulant trials and determine any possible health effects that could have been caused as a result. The study that was published in early 1999 concluded that the bacteria used were unlikely to have caused any health issues, such as miscarriages, chronic ill health, learning disabilities, or birth defects, and that these problems could not be attributed to the bacteria used in the trials. The report, however, did mention that any individuals suffering from any underlying disease processes could have been made more vulnerable to further illnesses and could have suffered from chest or blood infections. It was noted, however, that these cases would have presented within days of the spray trial and not 2 decades later. Of course, the end of the Dorset open-air trials didn't spell the end of research regarding biological warfare at Porton Down. The scientists from one of the UK's most secretive and controversial military research facilities continued their studies on biological and chemical agents that could threaten Britain's security, though due to the nature of these experiments, most of the work carried out is and will likely remain a secret for years to come. One of the key takeaways from the Dorset biological warfare experiments is the widespread testing of agents on a civilian population without their knowledge or consent. The Cold War in the West is often portrayed as an existential struggle of freedom against tyranny, but the line between those could often become very blurry in the interests of national security. We hope you've enjoyed today's episode, and to make sure you don't miss all of our future episodes, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and have sprayed vast amounts of E. coli across the countryside in an effort to infect people with the urge to press the bell button. What a shitty request. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all of our supporters, and if you aren't a patron, please consider supporting us at www.patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, I will leave you with the words of JFK. In the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air. We all cherish our children's future, and we are all mortal.